Painting portraits is my passion. I'm John Myatt, an artist, and I've been commissioned to paint famous people. But these will be no ordinary portraits, and I'm no ordinary painter. I used to be an art forger. I was jailed for forging over 200 paintings, a crime that rocked the art world. And I paid the price for it. I did my time, and now I make an honest living painting legitimate fakes in the style of famous artists. I'm copying the great masters to create my celebrity portraits, but I'm up against the clock. I have less than a day to do each one. And today my sitter is rock star Ian Brown. Ian was the lead singer of the Stone Roses, one of the UK's most iconic and best-loved bands. Their debut album is considered one of the finest British albums of all time. The Stone Roses were a huge inspiration for bands like Blur, Pulp and Oasis. Ian went solo after the Roses split and has since released 5 solo albums and 12 UK top 40 singles.
Today I'm painting Ian in the style of Paul Cézanne, an artist famous for working slowly and for making his sitters come back time after time just for one finished painting. Well, I don't have that luxury, so I'd better get cracking.
I've chosen a minimalist space to paint in so I can focus completely on Ian.
Well, hello.
Hi,
Ian.
John,
nice to meet you.
Great, nice to meet you.
Thanks for coming.
Ian. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for doing me. Lovely. It's my pleasure and privilege.
Oh, gosh.
Brilliant. I've seen your work.
Really? Okay. I'm going to try to paint you in the style of Paul Cézanne. So I want you to sit as still as you possibly can for about 4 or 5 hours.
I'll try.
If you can. And across there, if you will, please, Ian.
Just no worries.
Over there.
Cheers, John.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, just chuck that out, really. Marvellous. Well done. Are you comfy like that, Ian?
Feeling Cézanne-like.
Well, that's it then.
Paul Cézanne was born in 1839 and is called the father of modern art. He started painting when photography came into its own and was one of the first artists to turn away from a purely representational style. Instead, his paintings needed to have their own inner sense of harmony and balance, whether or not that corresponded with what was actually being painted.
So,
is there any reason why he chose Cézanne?
There's a lot of analogies between the way he painted and music.
Yeah, oh, you'd build it
up. Lots and lots of them. He'd start off, say, with just burnt umber, then he put a bit of green in.
Right.
And because he'd put a bit of green there, he had to put it there and then there. And then he put a bit of yellow ochre in. And because he put a bit of yellow ochre there, he had to put it there. And suddenly you've got all these things happening. Like at the top end of a frequency, you've got a little symbol, and at the bottom end, you've got, you know.
Right, yeah,
and
because
you put something else in, you go, ooh, I better put that in now.
Right.
Cézanne was totally driven by painting and always knew that that was what he wanted to do. For Ian, a chance encounter set him on his path. In 1984, at his then-girlfriend's 21st birthday party, he met the famous 60s soul singer, Gino Washington.
He told me that I should be a singer. He told me that everybody loved me, that I was a star, that I should be a singer. That's what I should do.
Had you been singing before?
Never sung, ever. No.
So someone that you didn't know but was famous came up to you and said, you should be a singer.
Yeah.
And what you're kind of going, what?
I was thinking, like, maybe, has he seen something inside me that I can't see? Why is he saying this? And he said, you know, I can see the people, how they respond to you and how you are with them, and you're a star and you should be a singer. And this is what he'd done.
So you'd never sung before?
No, nothing at all.
You just...
I played bass when I was about 16 in a group, but only for about 6 months. I had no ambition to do that, or thoughts to do it, and he sowed a seed in my mind.
Really?
Absolutely convinced, Ian immediately formed a band with some mates and started practicing. They called themselves the Stone Roses to combine something beautiful with something permanent. She's a waterfall.
I don't think at any time we didn't think that it was going to work out for us, because we believed in the music we were making, we believed in ourselves. It didn't matter that we had beans on toast every night for our tea. It didn't matter that we didn't have a lot of money. You just get used to it, don't you?
Mm.
We've been used to it anyway, and you just believe in what you do. It's what you do is more important than what you're going to gain from it, isn't it?
Yeah.
Cézanne never made a living from his painting, despite devoting his whole life to it. It was sheer determination that carried him through. At first, he was rejected by art schools, and then he was ridiculed by the critics.
He's one of those few people who I think really couldn't paint when he was young. He just wanted to. Early Cézanne's paintings were just very second rate. Rossetti was the same. And suddenly, just by doing it, because he had the time and the money that he could keep on painting, he suddenly discovered, when he was about 40, that he could actually paint. This happens to quite a lot of people who keep on going and don't quit. Suddenly they go, I can do this. But it takes them forever.
Cézanne would never have covered the canvas like this. Often he'd leave bare patches and worked stroke by stroke to build up detailed compositions. But I don't have time to be so meticulous or persistent. Ian's no stranger to persistence, and when the Stone Roses' groundbreaking debut album was released, it was an immediate commercial and critical success.
We spent 5 years working to get to that point.
Did you?
Yeah. Most of the songs then were written 85, 86, but they didn't get released till 89, yeah. It took us 4.5 years to get a record deal. Did 4.5 years unemployed, but I mean, that time, like you say, Cézanne had the time to paint, we had the time just to play. Yeah. Our manager owned a nightclub, so we just used to plug in at 10 o'clock and work till 10 o'clock every night, 5 days a week.
Best rehearsal, so the band's really tight.
Really tight. So there was one review when the album first came out, said we sounded like we'd been playing together for 20 years. Well, really we had, you know, done 5 years solid, like.
Massive success. Yeah. Lots of girls, presumably, or?
Yeah, well, I had a girlfriend at the time, but still, yeah.
Ian came from humble roots and grew up in Greater Manchester.
Your family were mainly factory workers or miners or railway workers, so I've seen how they used to live.
Yeah.
My father was a joiner, so he used to have to go working every weekend to make ends meet. So what I do is, I don't think they could dream a week of my life, my family, you know.
Are your parents alive?
Yeah.
What is their take on what their son is doing?
Oh, they love it. They come to the shows. They've been coming to my shows for 20 years, yeah. They used to be the only people in the crowd not in ecstasy in the late 80s. You know? So, what a great crowd you've got. Everyone loves each other and hugging each other. And I didn't have the heart to say, well, they're all in ecstasy. You know?
With such a successful first album, Ian should have made a lot of money, but the contract the band signed tied them into a deal they became very unhappy with.
Well, when we started out, we sort of thought that. We knew that the Beatles had been ripped off, so you're going to be ripped off. If you can rip the Beatles off, everybody's game, so...
Yeah.
But we didn't really expect it to be that bad. We went to court, and if we'd lost the case, we wouldn't have been able to make records again.
Get off it.
Our lawyer said, if you make a second album, you probably won't get paid on it. And we went to court in the High Court in the Strand. We were there 6 weeks.
The court case was protracted and took a heavy toll on the band. While the judge allowed them to leave the record company, he couldn't release them from their original deal on their debut album, which had gone platinum and sold over 1 million copies.
So we get like a fraction of a terrible deal, really.
Heartbreaking, so, and not really particularly good for the old creative
juices. We never really recovered
juices.
From that, really. That sort of destroyed us, really, the memento.
The music industry doesn't seem to change. It's always the same old story about bands, writers, always getting the sharp end of the deal.
It was a lesson learned, but I don't know what lesson I learned.
Would you say you're comfortably off now? Or?
I am now, because I've done 10 years solo, and I've had 5 albums and a greatest hits, and I've done 5 world tours, so...
Really?
Yeah.
I need to concentrate on the face now. Ian really has hit some low points in his life. In 1998, he was accused of air rage, allegedly threatening cabin crew and banging on the cockpit door during landing.
Yeah, I'm celebrating their 10 years anniversary yesterday.
Me too, nearly.
I got sent away in 98, yeah. I got sent away for saying words on an aircraft, likely to cause abuse.
Did you tell someone to...?
Well, I didn't even swear, actually. I was on the flight and the stewardess came along and said they wanted duty free. And she's seen us all sitting and she sort of waved her hand away dismissively. And I was like, don't wave your hand at me like that.
Oh dear.
And you know, she apologised and I said, apology's okay, but if you do it again, I'll cut it off. And this, I got 4 months for that. Which at the time was the same sentence that Gary Glitter got. Oh. And he'd had 4,000 indecent images of kids.
Unbelievable.
Strange ways I did.
That's a bit tough,
because,
isn't it?
Because I went into an open jail for the first 4 days and then I lost my appeal. My lawyer says I'm the only Category D that served his whole sentence in Category A jail.
I know.
Because he didn't want to put me back into the open prison because someone had phoned up saying, get him in the fields digging the potatoes and we'll get a photograph of him, it'll look good. So they panicked and they kept me in strange ways then.
Did you find Stone Roses fans inside?
I did think when I first went in, there's going to be somebody going to want to not, you know, put one on me because they're going to hear, oh, this pop star's come in jail and who does he think he is before I've even done anything? Mm. But I had kids who'd never even heard of the Stone Roses who ended up good friends with because they realised that I'd been stitched up, that I wasn't a criminal, you know. I got a lot of respect off kids because the way the authorities play their games, you know, when your mail lands and they shout out your name, instead of just shouting Brown and having... Obviously, people were writing me letters in there because they knew my music, so I probably was getting more letters than other lads in there. So we go, Brown, 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 and they do that as if to kind of wind the kids up. Mm. But it had the opposite effect, because they'd be like, well, why don't they just give me all in one go? So every time they tried to play them sort of games, I got people on my side who might not have been on my side.
When I was in Brixton, Nick, you know the way that they always find out what you're in there for, because the screws leave the screens on and stuff. And they used to go, Oi, Picasso! All right! But you know, I figured out there was a lot worse things you could be called Picasso. So I used to answer to it in the end.
And I'll be answering to Ian too if I don't get on with his portrait. It's all going very well, and I've done in 2 hours what Suzanne might have taken 2 weeks to do. But time's running out, and I need to get much more detail on this canvas. I'm painting rock star Ian Brown in the style of Paul Cézanne, and I've just an hour left to do it. You'll only see his portrait at the very end, and I hope he likes it enough to hang it in his own home. Cézanne was an extremely slow worker who demanded that his sitters keep absolutely motionless, probably why they often look so tired and somber. Once, he asked a man to return over 100 times before finally abandoning the painting with just 2 areas left unresolved.
He had this volcanic temperament, and he was also kind of fabulously pernickety. And just putting the two together, they did, as he grew older, the two just kind of got to be one person. And the moment he actually married those two parts of his personality, he turned into a painter.
Right. I realised that Ian and I have quite a lot in common, given that we've both spent some time in jail.
What was your experience like in prison?
I met some really nice people in there. Mm. They'd had really hard lives. A lot of kids just came from kids' homes, children's homes. They'd had no one to guide them in life. And when I first got to court on the day, there was kids there in ripped tracksuit pants and vests. And I was thinking, fancy coming to court like that. But it was only when I was banged up with them I realised, well, that's all they've got. That's why they've come to court like that. So it's just sad.
Mm. Now time to put in some more touches of Cézanne, starting off with the outline of the face.
There's a music to the edge of a line. I haven't got it here yet, but I will do. I'll finish off with it here. A line that is kind of elasticated, a line that is defined and then not defined, then defined again. A line, instead of just going, a line that actually sings as it goes round the shape of the head. That's quite important because one of the kind of facile things about Cézanne, the thing that Gauguin picked up, was this kind of, this hatching here that he did. These kind of marks that I'm putting on now. Those kind of, see, diagonal marks.
This technique adds planes of colour close together to create shading.
People really cancer me inside. get me phone cards and T-shirts that you need clothes when you first get
here. Yeah, you do, sure.
You know, lend you radios, lend you CDs, give you newspapers.
Yeah.
All big deal stuff, innit, you know. What I liked in there was like a lot of the ingenuity.
I've never seen people actually hitting batteries before. When batteries ran out, you know, people would just get a hold of mac them like this, bash it. And then get another couple of days out of it. I thought it was a bit strange the first time I saw it.
If you could have honed it, you know what I mean? A lot of the energy and the thoughts, if you could have honed it, them kids could have saved the world.
Did you write any songs in prison?
I wrote about four or five tunes from my second album while I was in there, I wrote one called Free My Way. It was deliberately about where I was, what was going on. Jingle jangle, here's the jailer. Because you can hear the keys coming, can't you?
Yeah.
5 minutes before they get there.
Jingle jangle, here's the jailer.
Cézanne was a wealthy landowner with a large country estate, so he was able to dedicate himself to painting. He would make his employees sit for him, hour after hour, year after year. He would revisit and rework paintings, sometimes taking up to 10 years to complete one. He was rarely happy with his efforts and during depressive moments would destroy his work. Ian himself reached a low point in 1996 when the Stone Roses split up. It was a classic rock and roll story, drugs, infighting and a record deal gone bad.
Yeah, the band split and shortly afterwards I split with the mother and my two kids, so I had quite a drastic change of life within a short period.
It could have been very easy at that point just to go under.
Yeah, well, I was lucky, really. I ended up in an ex-council house. I wasn't going to go under. I wasn't going to let myself be under. And it was up to me to dig myself out of that hole. So that's what you do, innit? When you find yourself in a hole, you've got to dig yourself out.
Yeah.
Is it true, Ian, that you were thinking of becoming a gardener?
Yeah, well, when the band finished, you know, the chaos and the grief and all the sort of business in my life, I wanted something really simple. And my grandfather and my maternal grandfather had had a little piece of land just before the war, and he used to grow flowers and take them to the market. And I always thought it must be a beautiful thing to do, just really simple. Grow your flowers, take them to the market. Beautiful, honest way of buying the world, I dug my back garden over. I got all the seeds ready. Thought, while I'm waiting, I better get on with a bit of music. And then I just turned the box room into a studio and I dug in and spent 8-9 months just working, that's all I did.
Ian's hard work paid off. It produced his first solo album, which went straight into the charts at number 4. And his career's gone from strength to strength. In the last 10 years, he's released 5 albums and the greatest hits.
You see, Cézanne would have made Ian sit bolt upright for just ages, and he would have spent forever just mark after mark after mark. And he wouldn't have really been after a likeness, like I am.
Just as he saw it?
Just little discreet moments, one after the other, steady as you go.
Is it looking Cézanne-like?
It is, actually. You see, and because I've used this pink now, I have to now find other places on this canvas where I can put it. And the other thing, of course, that was sort of unique to Cézanne was, and Impressionism as a whole, but particularly Post-Impressionism, was the finish. Each brush mark was an individual decision and stood there. It wasn't smoothed into the next one. It was a discrete decision at that point. So we've only got 3 colours working. We've got this flesh colour here, obviously the dark colours, which we'll come back to. Now this pink. We can find it down here, can't we? Aren't we lucky that Ian's got those stars? Because we will have one there, one there, one there, and one there. And that will unite our little colour scheme as it goes round.
OK, I've got just minutes left to finish this painting.
Beautiful nose you've got, Ian.
I was wanting a proper nose, it's just a little button nose.
It's lovely, don't worry about it, it's gorgeous.
Cézanne continued working right up to his death from pneumonia in 1906. His influence on other great painters such as Picasso and Matisse earned him the posthumous title, the Father of Modern Art.
Right, well, that's it. I think that's all I can do in the time we've got, Ian. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
I'm going to frame the painting, and then when you come back, you'll see it. It's been a real pleasure.
Thanks
thank
a
you
lot
so
for
much
me.
For your time.
Thanks a
I'm
lot.
I'm going to take
thank
it easy
you.
For a moment.
Thanks a lot.
And then you'll come back and see the painting.
All right, lovely. Thank you.
Thank you.
I've been really impressed by Ian's openness. I just hope he'll be as impressed by my painting.
I've loved watching him work, but being unable to see him is... I'm itching to see it. Really enjoyed it, and I've loved his company as well. I started feeling a little nervous maybe 10 minutes ago. But till then I remained calm, and now I'm in between calm and nervous. I'll say if I don't like it, but I'm expecting to like it.
Ian, your portrait by me in the style of Paul Cézanne. Here we go.
Wow, yeah. You definitely got the likeness. It looks like a Cézanne too. Wow, I think it's great.
I need another day.
What would you do in a day?
I don't know, I just tweak and tweak and tweak. I do what he did. I just worry it to death.
God, what colours you got in the face?
The green comes in from there, the red comes in from there, and I think I've more or less got your eyes in the right place. I was a bit worried about that eye because it was, as we went on, it was pretty much in shadow. You like it?
I mean, yeah, I do, I love it. Like you said early on, Cézanne might have painted me and he wouldn't have painted a necessary likeness of me, but there is a likeness of me, I can see that. And also I can see Cézanne.
Yes.
You're never going to starve you, John. It's brilliant. Will you sign it for me, please? Just as master.
Should I do that?
Yeah, do that.
Yes. That's good, isn't it? You know, that's one of the first times I've ever signed it.
Great. I know you're not supposed to admire pictures of yourself, are you? But
yeah,
you're not
sure.
Supposed to laugh at your own jokes. That's great.
Put it there,
thanks
sir.
For doing that. Thanks a lot.
Thanks, boss. Thank you very
brilliant.
Much. You're a brilliant
you artist. Keep going, you're a brilliant painter. It's going in my front room, that. To knock that out in a few hours is beyond genius. It's amazing. What a skill. I always tell my kids, if you can draw, you're never going to starve. And this man's always going to have a full belly from what I can see.
If my name was Paul Cézanne, we would be up there for another fortnight painting that portrait, but it isn't. And in the time we had, I don't think we did too badly.